Oh, Good morning, Pilgrim family. Once again, we have been blessed to come to another worship experience. We give God praise and thanks for the diligence of Pilgrim Baptist Church. We thank you for your prayers, but most of all, we thank you for your continued support of the ministry at Pilgrim Baptist. We ask that you continue to pray for the covering and the safety of all, not just our members, but people everywhere. The coronavirus is rising again, and we know that many are perishing because of it. We ask that you will pray for the bereaved. Death, amen, has not skipped over members of Pilgrim. Pray for some of those who have lost their loved ones. And we come and we ask that you will continue to support by way of PayPal, by way of your giving or mail-in. But most of all, we ask that you will continue to support our Mindful Noonday Prayer and our Bible studies on Wednesday and our services on Sunday. These things are being projected for you so that we can keep you inspired, informed, uplifted, and spiritually strong during this time of the virus. So we ask that you come and join us this morning as we go to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 19, verses 16 through that of 22, as we speak to you, instructions to eternal life. Amen. Instructions to eternal life. Come join us now and be prepared to give God the praise. Good morning, my brothers and sisters. This is a day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We welcome you once again to another worship experience. We come together to lift up praises to a wise and sovereign and almighty God, one who has covered us and has kept us along the way. During these times, we need a Savior. During these times, we need a friend. And we can truly put our trust in Almighty God. We ask that you join us this morning as we come to you from the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 19. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 19, beginning at verse 16. Of this chapter, I'll be reading from the New King James Translation for our understanding. These words are penned for you and I. And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? And he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is, God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments. He saith unto him, Which? Jesus said, Thou shalt do no murder, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. The young man said unto him, All these things I have kept from my youth up. What lack I yet? Jesus said unto him, If thou wilt be perfect, go and sell that thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. I want to just take a moment as we stop there, verses 16 through that of 22. And speak to you from the thought, instructions to eternal life. Just want to talk about instructions to eternal life. Jesus had a man, an encounter with the Pharisees concerning that of the marital status of one who had married and divorced. And he and his disciples now, amen, was leaving this encounter after Jesus, amen, talked to them concerning a maternal love. He looks and he had already stated unto them concerning the little children, suffer the little children and forbid them not to come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of God. Here Jesus, amen, was teaching, amen, and giving promises to that of children, how he had covered them. But now, amen, as he departed thence, here comes one that is known as the rich young ruler. Here he was a man full of pride. He was full of conceit. He was wealthy, amen. And he wanted an audience with the Lord. And here in verse 16, he comes unto him by stating, "Good master." Amen. He greets him, amen, in a way that was unusual for a man, the Jews. They never, amen, used good with master. But here this young man reverenced Christ, amen, in an ultimate way. But look at what he asked. This was a question that was posed to Christ. "Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may, amen, have eternal life?" I want to just take a moment as to his reverencing Christ. When he says, "Good master," amen, he did not mean ruler, but he meant teacher, a great instructor, one who taught with power and authority. Here he comes to him, amen, and shows his humility by calling him master. Good, amen. Jesus takes a moment and Jesus says, "Why are you calling me good? There's only one." So he did not, amen, put him in place, but he put him in remembrance of God and the God of all of our salvation. Jesus did not allow him to just focus on him, but he was pointing him back to the Father. And he says, "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one. That is God." Oh, look at the goodness of God. Look at a man, how God has taken pity upon all of us who are his children, who are his creation. There is none like God. And here he says, "None but God." That's the only good thing that you can desire, and that is God. But he looks as he teaches this young man who thought that he had it all wrapped up. See, brothers and sisters, we can't get too comfortable with our religion. We can't get too comfortable with our Christianity because, amen, we have work to still do. And brothers and sisters, I want us to understand something. If thou wilt enter into life, here Jesus says unto him, "Keep the commandments." Oh, brothers and sisters, I stopped by just to let you know that God is wanting obedience from his children. Yes, this young man came to Jesus seeking amen, knowledge to eternal life. All of us have had questions about how we are to get to the other side. All of us wonder, amen, what we must do. But he put emphasis on good things. Oh, I come to bad record. Now you're looking at works righteousness. And works righteousness won't pay your way into eternity. He looking at good things that he can do on this side, other than to submit totally unto the sovereignty of Almighty God. A lot of people are doing good things, but they will not submit, amen, to the calling of Almighty God. They will not commit to his commandments. And here this young man questions Jesus, and Jesus is receptive of his question. He was not angered. He was not put down, but he welcomed, amen, the question that the young man had inquired about. All of us need to know the things that we must do to inherit eternal life. But he asked, what good thing? Which means they were more ceremonial than they were spiritual. And he wanted to know, what good works shall I do? What mighty deeds shall I perform, amen, in order to go to the other side? I look around now, and we have a whole lot of people today, amen, who need to ask this question. Stop thinking that you have it made because you are the member of the church. Stop thinking you have it made just because you are working in a ministry. Amen. Be careful, amen, not to take it for granted just because you may be a choir member, a usher, deacon, or a trustee. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we have to work out our soul salvation on this side with fear and with trembling. This young man, amen, was conceited in his own right, because he turns around when Jesus says, keep, amen, the commandments. He turns around and says, now which commandment, Jesus? Amen, you are telling me to keep the commandments, but which ones are you looking for me, amen, to keep? And brothers and sisters, here we go again. Jesus, amen, plainly, amen, directs him to the last six of the commandments coming out of the Ten Commandments. First thing he said, thou shalt not do no murder. In other words, don't be taking somebody's life, amen, in your own hand. Don't be shedding innocent blood, amen. You need to look at yourself as well as your neighbor. Thou shalt not commit adultery, amen. Thou shalt not be lustful over somebody else's wife or husband. But yet and still, he takes that and says, look at yourself and look at your neighbor. Thou shalt, amen, not steal. If you hadn't worked for it, amen, you ought to leave it alone. Don't be stealing and robbing from your neighbor or your friend. Here he says, now look at somebody's reputation. He said, thou shalt not bear false witness. Oh, we got a whole bunch of liars running around. We got a whole lot of folk who don't care about somebody's name or their reputation. We ought to, amen, be our brother and sister's keeper. We ought to love one another in such a way that we would not bear false witness. We would not lie, amen, on somebody else. Amen. Being saved mean that we have truth in us. Our loins are girded with truth. Amen. When you deal with the word of God, you are not deceitful. So why is it that the young people in the world said, if you want to find liars, just go to the church. If you want to find backstabbers, just go to the church. Here Jesus, amen, is telling this young man, amen, what he needs to perform in order that he might inherit eternal life. But look at this. He says, honor now thy father and thy mother. Oh, brothers and sisters, this is a filial love. This is honoring a man, your parents, your relatives, having respect for those who brought you into this world. And most of the time, he had to do it because if he was a rich young ruler, it meant that his riches had come from his inheritance. It would put us in line to think that his father and his mother may be passed along. But yet and still, amen, he says to honor. And I look around and I see children dishonoring mother and father. Don't have two nickels to make a dime and trying to talk back. Brothers and sisters, I come to bear record. The Bible even teaches us, if you spare the rod, you spoil the child. I know that time out is good, but there's sometimes when time out needs to be time in, and you need to tighten up, amen, what's going on in the world. Amen, if you don't get them, the law will get them. And I'd rather, amen, instruct my own rather than somebody else. He says, so honor thy mother and thy father. And go on with that scripture, that thy days may be prolonged upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. I've seen a whole lot of young people dishonor parents, and some of them, amen, did not reach the age of 30. They are already on the other side. The Bible teaches us, and that is, amen, a commandment with promise. And I want you to understand, when it's a commandment, it's not a request. It's something that God says he needs for us to do. When we look at the commandments, when we look at what the Lord is trying to tell us, it's not a request, but because God understood that it was hard for man to keep the Ten Commandments, amen, God was preparing to send a remedy for mankind. Not only that, but he says, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Oh, amen. He talks about, amen, loving and forgiving, being pitiful on others who may not know the Lord like you know him. There's a lot of people who are suffering right now. There's a lot of people who are depressed right now, all because they don't know to put their trust in God. When you have God on your side, this love is a brotherly love. This love is a neighborly love. Amen. But to do this to your neighbor is the duty that Christ, amen, is teaching us to do. Christians ought not to be angry and mad at one another. You ought to be able, amen, to reconcile and move on. Amen. Serve the right, amen, to agree sometimes, to disagree. Everybody is not going to be on the same wavelength. Everybody is not going to be right all the time. So we learn how to compromise. Jesus here was letting us know that if you're going to be his child, you got to learn how to love. You got to learn how to love, not because of, but in spite of. You got to learn how to love because God first loved us and sent his only son. And here, look at what the young man had to say. The young man looked at Jesus after Jesus, amen, instructs him with the six things, amen, between man and his fellow man. Note now that the first four are not mentioned, and that's the man's relationship with God. It is hard to deal with one another when you don't have God in your life. It's hard, amen, to get along with some knuckleheads when you don't have God and the Spirit in your life. It's hard, amen, to forgive those who have wronged you and done all manner of evil against you if you don't have the love and the Spirit of God. We got to have a connection with God. Jesus here was tutoring this young man and instructing him as to the way of living and living a life that would bring him joy, happiness, amen, and pleasure on this side. Yes, he had money. Jesus already knew where his heart was. And I come to bear record, you better watch, amen, what questions you ask, and you might just get an answer you may not be looking for. This young man looks at Jesus. I said, Jesus, amen, I've done these things from my youth up. What lack I, amen, yet, amen. So Jesus looked at this young man and says, if you want to be perfect, oh, I look at this right here, perfection, he means without a blemish from the young man, but Jesus means if you're going to be spiritually mature, if you're going to know God for yourself, he says, you got to get rid of some things. He says, go and sell what you have, amen, because it is holding you back from doing the will of Almighty God. You are worshiping your material things more than God. Yes, you have done, amen, amen, church work, but you have not, amen, the Spirit to do the work of the church. Jesus here looks at him when he says, go and sell that thou hast and give to the poor. First of all, he says you ought to shake off some stuff. You ought to look at self-sacrifice if you're talking about being perfected. We got a lot of folk right now, their love is the mighty dollar. If it's green, there is no other color. If you are broke, busted, and disgusted, they won't even look at you because they are materialistic. Jesus here, knowing the heart of the young man, that's what I want to bring about. The works, amen, that we do are insufficient if we don't have the love of Almighty God in our lives. I stopped by just to let you know, during this time of the pandemic, I've seen a lot of people who have self-sacrifice in helping other folk. What Jesus is saying is the only good thing for a neighbor to do. If you see your brother and sister in need, he's saying you ought to use some of your resources trying to help somebody along the way. He says here, sell that you have and give to the poor. I want you to know that almsgiving and benevolent giving should come from the heart. When God has blessed you abundantly to help somebody along the way, God will replace whatever you dispense. For he says right here in the text, go now and sell that you have. In other words, he did not say just give a man your stuff away, but he says you need to be industrious. You need to go now and sell some of the things that you have in excess, the things that you have just laying around. So many times we got stuff in our closet that still have tags on them. We can't wear them no more, and we won't get rid of them. The Lord says, don't be a hoarder, but learn how to give, and give to those who may really need it. And the young man listened, and Jesus says, then thou shalt have treasure in heaven. When you do this, come on back now and follow me. I want you on my side, but you gotta shake off some things and humble yourself and come under the auspices of the gospel of Christ. He says, but the young man heard these things and went away sorrowful in heart. See, when you want the truth of how to get the glory, you got to love and forgive people that you might not like. I stopped by to let you know that we are living in a time when hatred is all over the place, when anger, malice, and backstabbing, murder, all in the streets. We can't get along with one another because everybody wants to be the head. But I stop by to let you know, when you come into the encounter of Jesus for yourself, like this young man who went away sorrowful, it means that he could not give up his riches. His God was his material things. Don't get caught up, amen, worshiping what God has blessed you with. You gotta learn how to humble yourself. You gotta learn how to hang in there. When the Lord blesses you, you ought to give him more praise. When the Lord lifts you up, you ought to give him more praise. It's all right to praise him when things are good, but can you praise him when things go bad? But I stop by to let you know, don't hang your head and don't walk away sorrowful, because if God has blessed you, all he wants you to do is give him praise. Go ahead and glorify his name. Go ahead and magnify him. Ain't he all right? I know he's all right. I know he's all right. Instructions to eternal life. Jesus, a man was taking his time, and he told the young man, but the young man walked away sorrowful. Don't leave Jesus, a man, for those things that will go away. Don't leave, a man, the Holy One, running after things on this side. I stopped by to let somebody know, I don't know who I'm talking to, but you gotta stop worshiping things. Here the Lord have already blessed you, and he kept you on this side of Jordan, but he wants you to understand, every good thing has come from the Father. Every good gift God has given you. If God can bless you in your sins, what would he do if you came on his side? Jesus wants us to know, it's not bad to be wealthy or rich. The love of money is the sin of the world. But I stopped by to let you know that God got some rich Christians. God got some well-to-do Christians who don't mind helping a man and lending a helping hand. So I come to battle record. Jesus was already aware of what it was going to take to get rid of of the ceremonial attitude. Some of us got a ceremonial attitude. We come to church when we want to come. We give when we want to give. But God, it keeps on blessing you, trying to show you how good he is. But I come to bear record. I'm so glad that Jesus did not rebuke the young man, but gave him instructions to eternal life. Some of us need to be reminded how good God is. If God didn't forgive us, where would we be? If God didn't answer us, what would we do? But I come to let you know, it's time during this pandemic to give God praise. During this presidential election, give God praise. Don't wait till the battle is over. Go ahead and praise him now. He teaches us how to glorify his name. I know he's all right. I know God is all right. He brought us all a mighty long way, and he's not through with any of us yet. If you still got breath in your body, God is still using you. Go ahead and tell somebody about the goodness of Almighty God. Go ahead and tell somebody that you know him for yourself. Ain't he all right? Can I get a witness? Can you praise him, Pilgrim? Can you praise the Lord? Can you give him glory? Can you magnify his name? Somebody praise him. Somebody glorify him. Look around and see what the Lord has already given you. See the good things that's all around you. Glory be to God. What must we do to be saved? Instructions to eternal life. Keep the commandments. Keep the word of God in your heart. Brothers and sisters, this is a time when all we have to do is keep his commandments. Trust him in all that we do. Trust him with the things of this world. He's still in control. Maybe there's someone listening. You may not know the Lord. You may be like this young man. You may have inquired in your own spiritual body, what must I do to be saved? You might even have asked yourself, can I be saved? And let me tell you, you can. No matter what your past may be, the Lord is still looking at you. And if you're listening to this message, know that he came for the sinner. There's still time for you to come to know the Savior for yourself. If that's you, would you take a moment and just repeat after me? Father, I ask you into my life. Yes, I have sinned, but I realize I need you now. I've been short. A lot of things I have not done right. But I believe that Jesus came, he bled, he died for my sins. But he rose again from the grave, having all power in his hand. Father, come into my life. Mold me and shape me into what you would have me be. And I will give you glory. I will give you honor and much much praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, may the grace of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ, and his Spirit continue to rest, rule, and abide with us henceforth, now and forevermore. Let every heart say, amen. God bless you, Pilgrim. We love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Have a blessed day.
Question is, when you're standing at a crossroads,
what do you do?
Real sweet, when a fork is in the road.
When a fork is in the road, what do you do?
When the world is on your shoulders.
When the world is on your shoulders.
When your back is up against the wall.
When your back is up against the wall.
Come on.
What do you do?
What do you do?
What do you do?
You hold on.
You hold on.
And keep the faith.
And keep the faith.
Tell somebody on your road. Say. Come on, tell somebody sitting around you, keep the faith.
Keep the faith.
Come on, encourage somebody else, keep the faith.
Keep the faith.
Come on, where do you look?
Where do you look?
When there's nowhere else to look.
When there's nowhere else to look.
Where do you turn? When there's nowhere else to turn.
When there's nowhere else to turn.
Where do you go?
Where do you go?
When there's nowhere else to go.
When there's nowhere else to go.
What do you do?
What do you do?
When there's nothing else to do.
When there's nothing else to do.
You gotta remember, you're in the Master's hand.
In the Master's hand.
And the Master has a plan.
And the Master has a plan.
So hold on. And keep the faith.
Keep the faith.
Keep the faith.
Thank you.
Keep the faith.
Keep the faith.
Keep the faith.
Keep the faith.